I'm sure you want to go through it. Our last speaker, Professor Stephen Simpson, is widely known in the scientific community for his cutting-edge research in the physiology of nutrition. His work has deep implications in the fields of ecology, evolution, agriculture, and human health. Together with his colleague Dr. Robert Harper, Steve has developed an iterative modeling framework for nutrition, which has been applied to a wide range of organisms, from microorganisms to humans, and programs from aquaculture and dietary causes of human obesity and aging. In addition to nutritional biology, his research on locusts has led to an understanding of locus swarming, that means chemical events in the brain of individual insects, to landscape scale mass migration. Today, he will take us on a journey from cannibal locus to new insights on human appetite, obesity, and the relationship between food and aging.
Hospitality and deliciousness of food, if I'm to maintain my body mass and my body composition as it is now, then I would need to eat 1,500 kilojoules a day in the form of protein, and the remainder of my energy, that's 9,500 kilojoules, coming from carbohydrate and or fat. It doesn't matter for the argument that I'm going to develop here. What you can think of, therefore, is my daily nutrient requirements is representable as a target. And if I can get to that target, then I will have achieved simultaneously protein requirements and also my non-protein energy needs. I will be in a state of having achieved my requirements for those two major nutrient dimensions. A diet that allows me to do that, if you were to mush up everything that I ingested during a 24-hour period and represent it as a ratio, that ratio would be the one that we would control. That ratio would be one that went through that point, and that, by definition, is a balanced diet. Now, the nutrient balance problem that faces humanity today, as we'll see, is that our diet is increasingly imbalanced. So I just need to develop the idea of what happens when you're faced with a nutritionally imbalanced diet. Let's say, and this is true, and I'll develop this a little bit further, that the human diet, particularly the Western human diet, is becoming somewhat diluted in its protein, such that nowadays our diet contains lower than a 15% protein diet. Now, what's the challenge? If I'm stuck on that diet, and my intake requirements, my target, if you like, is sitting over here, if I stick to that diet, it's a little bit like being on a railway line. As I eat that diet day after day, I'm going to be heading off in this direction, inexorably, in the wrong direction. I'll never ever get to my target because that line is just going in the wrong direction. Every mouthful I take of that diet will take me away in the wrong direction. What should I do? Well, what I might do is make the decision to stop when I get to this point here, so I've achieved my requirements for carbohydrates and fat, 9,500 kilojoules. If I did that, I'd end up eating too little protein. And that's not good. Alternatively, I might keep eating until I get to the point up here, whereupon I've got my target requirement of protein. But in so doing, I will have grossly exceeded my requirements for carbohydrates and fat. My total energy intake will be substantially more than required. Or I might do something else. For example, I might stop when I get to this point here, which is when I've got the same number of calories as at my target point. Now, Carlos earlier introduced the idea of counting calories, and calories not really being enough as a currency to account for the nutrient balance problem. And here's why. I can get to the same number of calories at that point as I would have at the target, but my nutrient balance would be wrong. So the question is, what will I do when I'm put onto an imbalanced diet? Where will I stop? And knowing the answer to that turns out to be absolutely fundamental in understanding the development of the human obesity crisis. Now, if I was a locust, this is what I would do. Firstly, I would have sufficient nutritional wisdom, just like a Drosophila, to get myself to my target if I had available foods that allowed me to do so. If I could choose between high carbohydrate and high fat diet and my protein diets, I would mix the two and I would get myself to that point. And they have very sophisticated mechanisms for doing that. But that's not the question. My question is, what happens if they can't get there? Well, to answer that, what you do is you confine individual locusts to diets that have different ratios. Either a lower ratio of protein to carbohydrate, there's a whole series of different rails or lines here that would be of that category, or a diet which contains a higher than optimal ratio of protein. blue dots represent their behavioural outcomes, the amounts of nutrients that they eat in these different circumstances. What you'll see is that these together form a pattern. And that pattern is described very simply as follows. When my diet as a locust contains a lower proportion of protein than at my target, then what I do is I keep eating and I exceed my requirements for carbohydrate to gain limiting protein. In contrast, when I'm on a higher than optimal protein diet, then I don't overeat protein to gain limiting carbohydrate. So the net result of that, of course, is that on low protein diets, locusts will overconsume total energy. The net result of that is that they become obese and die early. It's pretty hard to tell whether a locust is obese. They have an exoskeleton, but they're very fat on the inside. It's a little bit like a medieval knight being wedged into a suit. Now, in contrast, there's also a cost to eating a diet that contains too high a proportion of protein, because these locusts, because they stop eating before they exceed their protein requirement by too much, end up eating too little energy. And the net result of that is that they end up very lean and hence susceptible to starving in an environment where food may become limited. And that's a real problem if you're a locust. So, I want you to keep that shape in mind, because that shape defines the way that this animal, and I'll come back to how we do the same thing, balances eating too much of carbohydrate against too little protein, and vice versa on imbalanced diets. But I'm just going to now take a little bit of a side trip and address a question which was raised earlier about social influences on feeding. And I'm going to take the circumstance where not locusts this time, but a related mass migrating insect find themselves in a state of protein deficit. What happens? Well, firstly, I'll introduce the organism. This is a thing called the Mormon cricket. Now, it's called the Mormon cricket because it lives in Utah. It's famous, in fact, there's a statue next to the main Mormon temple in Salt Lake City dedicated to the seagull. The seagull is the state bird, Utah, and the seagull saved the Mormon pioneers when they first arrived at Salt Lake and crossed the continent, and they looked down upon what they thought was going to be a beautiful freshwater lake surrounded by green vegetation. It turned out to be hypersaline and unusable. They planted their first crops, they starved through that first season, and just as the crops were coming to fruition, they were just about to harvest them. Down over the hills came a horde of Mormon crickets. And the pioneers tried to beat off the Mormon crickets. They were failing, they used fire, they used water, and they were saved by the seagulls that came down, and flocks descended upon the crickets and ate them. But anyway, this is what they look like. This is a marching band of Mormon crickets. Each one is about the size of a little thumb. This band crossed the road continuously for 5 days. They travel about 1 to 2 kilometers a day, so you can just imagine the numbers of animals. We wanted to answer the question, why are they doing that? Why are they mass marching? Because they're marching together in serried ranks, rather like an army, through the habitat. And to answer that question, we sat in front of a marching band, and we placed in front of them dishes of diets. So this is a little bit like putting down different types of sushi in front of a marching band and a locust. Now, sushi in this case was a dry, granular, rather unappetizing artificial diet, but we had complete control over the nutritional quality of those different diets. So what we have here is a dish of diets that contains both protein and carbohydrate, 21 Here's another dish which contains carbohydrate but no protein. This one, protein but no carbohydrate. And this has neither protein nor carbohydrate. It's just a dry, flocculent base mixture that contains vitamins and salts and so on that's found in all four. So what I'm going to show you now is the Morgan crickets as they approach these dishes. Hoping that's working. Bear in mind while you're watching this that these animals, like many insects, taste with their feet, which is an unsavory prospect that they do. They also taste with their antennae and their mouthparts. They've never in their entire evolutionary history encountered these foods. But just watch what they do, and watch the decisions they're making as they contact the foods. So what's happening, anybody? Strongly now. There's a whole range of different studies. And we've since done this more recently with another 20 or so other studies that have been done, and the shape is becoming even more apparent. So it looks as if we humans too have this strategy that if we're on a low protein diet, then we prioritize intake of protein and overconsume other energy sources that come with it. Well, one of the problems with those sorts of experiments is that people are able to recognize the foods that they're eating. So there's the possibility that they're making subjective decisions about whether they like certain things or not, and that might be confusing the experiment. There's also the problem that by removing certain foods from the buffet or in other experimental regimes, you're changing the variety of foods made available, and variety influences how much you eat. So to try and get around those problems, we had to design a study where we disguised the nutrient content of foods and kept people for week-long periods where they had what they thought were the same menus week on week for three separate weeks, but in fact, we designed the foods such that in 1 week, everything they ate was 10% protein, in another week, it was 15% protein, and in the third week, it was 25% protein. During that week, they had a whole range of main meals and snacks and all sorts of other things, which were sensorily different. They had different flavors, they had different characteristics, but they were all the same. They manufactured them and designed them that way and tested them to be undetected in them. They were subjectively, they were thought to be the same. So, here we have a lunch in the 10% week and a lunch, equivalent lunch, in the 25% week. There are wraps and sushi rolls and apricot muffins and salad and low-fat dressing, which sort of provides a little greenery, but no energy. You actually lose energy when you eat those things, right? Yeah. So we then had people eat what they wanted. They were taken for a supervised walk each day, because if you let them out on their own, people will cheat. People are notorious for cheating in these experiments. Actually, one of the most challenging things in the whole of nutrition research is to get accurate measures of what people eat. Anyway, what I'm going to show you now is the three points that came from that study superimposed upon that array that I showed you just before. Here they are. So even when people had no idea that they were eating different menus each week, nutritionally different, they still showed this behavioral response. In particular, when they were on the low protein 10% week, they ate a total of nearly 15% more energy. And they did that, it transpired in a rather interesting way. They didn't eat more during meals, they ate more between meals, by snacking, and particularly by snacking on savory flavored snacks. And as we've heard already, savory flavors, such as umami, as Brian said at the beginning, are cues associated with protein. As Paolo intimated, the potato chip is the classic protein decoy because it contains umami and salt, two cues that are associated normally with protein, but it's just packaged up with fat and carbs. We have just very recently completed the same study using culturally relevant foods that we had to design again from scratch, but nutritionally the same, in Jamaica. And here are the three points that come from that study. They superimpose throughout the museum. So what we have here is, I think now, really solid evidence that we humans are behaving like locusts and like rodents, and we're responding subliminally to the macronutrient balance in our diet, and that protein and the regulation of protein is apparent. And our bodies care more about the regulation of its intake than they do of the intake of other nutrients. And as Carlos said in his talk, we can start to tease apart the mechanisms that are involved in that sort of response, whether it be in flies or other humans. But I just want to take you through the implications of that response, because they're substantial. Let's see what happens if the diet shifts towards containing a lower percent protein. Well, what that's going to do is force people, their protein habits have been dominant, will force them to overconsume total energy. Unless you get rid of that, then you're going to be prone to developing obesity or metabolic disease. And just to give you a feel for the power of that effect, if you go back to 1960, the US population, it's estimated, gained 14% of its total energy intake in the form of protein. The rest is fat and carbohydrate. By the year 2000, that dropped by what seems to be a trivial amount, down to 12.5%, largely through increased consumption of simple sugar and fat. Now, the geometry of this is stark. This is straight Euclidean geometry, something we all learned in school. To maintain their absolute protein intake constant, which is what the American population did, they had to eat a total of 14% more energy. And that, of course, would be catastrophic in terms of weight gain, and made worse by the fact that, over the same period, people were expending less energy. So if you expend less energy through being less active, spending more time in the car, more time watching screens, playing games, laying on the couch, whatever, then that's effectively the same as dropping your target down this way, because that energy comes principally from that dimension. Your protein needs are the same, but your total energy needs are the dimension. So the net result is that if you dilute protein even a small amount of the diet, overconsumption and all the problems that go with that. That begs the question, of course, why has that dilution occurred? And that's a complex, well, it's a question that has a set of complex answers. And I'll just give you a couple of reasons why it has happened. One of them is that there's an economic pressure to dilute protein in the diet. If you do an economic analysis, which we did, you can show very clearly that protein is the most expensive of the nutrients. It's more expensive than fat. Fat is more expensive than carbohydrate. So it's now quite clear in the developed world that obesity is a growing problem which disproportionately affects the less affluent. So that makes sense in terms of economics. There's also an economic pressure acting on the producers of food. And that, of course, means the removal of expensive protein and its replacement with fat and carbohydrate. So we have a double whammy. In fact, we have a triple whammy because that same economic pressure is acting on the producers of feeds that go to feed our livestock, our food animals, whether they be fish or whether they be animals, land animals. So therefore, if you look at game, the traditional game animals have about 2% of their body weight as fat, or their meat as fat, whereas a typical farmed animal is up around 20%. So there's an economic pressure that's acting in three ways to cause that dilution. There's also a loss of cooking skills, and there's also the inheritance of our Paleolithic ancestry, where we do have a particular liking for simple sugars and fats, and that probably reflects our evolution of ancestry. There are other reasons as well, and the net result, however, is that our diet is shifting ever so subtly towards a lower percent of protein, and this response, through sprayed old Euclidean geometries, is forcing us to overconsume. If, on the other hand, the diet increases in percent protein, then what happens is you're going to eat less total energy. And that would aid you in losing weight. And that's why the Atkins diet works and many of the other fad diets work, because they're all high in percent protein. You get to the protein target earlier, your body doesn't mind you overeating protein, and you'll therefore stop having underconsumed total energy. But that begs the question, why do we not overeat protein? Now, it's pretty easy to understand why we don't under-eat protein, because protein is the only source of nitrogen among the major macronutrients in our diet. You need nitrogen to build new tissues, to build new enzymes, and you otherwise just can't survive. Particularly needed during a period of growth, or for reproductive growth. So, that's easy. You can understand, therefore, why animals might eat more to gain lifting protein. But why do they not move lifting protein? As an evolutionary biologist, the implication for me is that there's a cost, there's some problem with over-consuming protein. And we set about trying to answer that cost using, you guessed it, prosomal. So what we did here was we confined 1,000 flies to one of 28 diets varying in their proportion of protein and carbohydrate, and we measured how much they drank as individual flies throughout their lives. Now this is a 5 microliter per pet, which is vanishingly small, because the flies are vanishingly small as well. And as they drink from here, the meniscus drops through to, from the top of the pet, and you can measure how much they drank and hence how much nutrients they ingested. So for each fly, we have a measure of how much it ate, protein and carbohydrate, and we can associate with those individual points consequences for the flies. Well, I'm going to show you here two consequences, and these are big consequences. One is how long the flies live, and the other is how many eggs they lay across their lifetime. These are female flies. Now what you'll see here is another device for expressing nutritional responses that we use, and that's a surface. This is like a landscape, a topology. And the highest point on the topology is in the red, and the lowest points are down in the dark blue. What you can see here, the lifespan, is that flies lived longest when they had a diet that contained about a 1 to 16 ratio of protein to carbohydrate. If it contained less protein than that, they became obese and had problems. But any higher than that in percent protein, and you'll see that you descend down the longevity landscape, they live progressively less long. You'll also note that egg production has a differently shaped mountain, response mountain. They produce most eggs on a 1 to 4 higher protein diet. But again, if protein was beyond that in its percentage in the diet, even egg production fell. So the conclusion is that protein is needed for growth and reproduction, yes, but too much short lifespan in flies at least. Now, just this week, we've also got the data that came from a massive study we undertook with mice, where we confined over 1,000 mice, or just 100,000 mice, to 130 diets, in which we varied fat, protein, and carbohydrate as three dimensions, and we've just got the same answer. So mice, too, live longest when their diet contained a percentage of protein that was not too high. If you increase the percent of protein, then they start to suffer and live less long. If you make it too low, they become obese, that's true. But elevated intake of protein comes at a cost. So, we've come to the end of a journey which has included camel crickets, aging, obesity in humans, and I could have used many other illustrations of nutritional wisdom from around the biological world. If you ever did want to follow up any of those, there's a book that's coming out on the 4th of July, in fact, which summarizes many of these examples and takes you through animal production, pet nutrition, ultimately through to how ecological systems work and how conservation nutrition can help you conserve endangered species, as well as human babies. So there we are. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. If you let them eat freely, Where's that point? Why would that be, whatever that point is, why is that point there?
That's a really good question. So you can have, if you measure different things, you'll get different shaped landscapes. That's absolutely right. And that begs the question, what does the fly care about? So to give them a choice and let them go where they want, in other words, to allow the expression of their regulatory systems, you can get them to tell you what they care about. That red line shows you where they go. They head along that red line if you give them choices of foods, inexorably like a nutrient-seeking missile, to the top of the surface that maximizes lifetime egg production. Now, Darwin predicted that in 1859. If you maximize lifetime egg production, then you're going to leave largest numbers of progeny, and your progeny and your genes will therefore become concentrated in the gene pool over time. So that's the answer to your question. They care about reproductive output. We don't, in the sense that we've become rather coupled. What matters more to us in our day-to-day lives, you might call our health span, how long we live, and how healthy we are during those years. And optimizing diet with respect to that is a major task at the moment facing the field of human nutrition.
It was a really, really interesting talk. I wanted to ask, I don't know if this makes sense or not, but I would say that there's some kind of biological response to what the animal is actually doing, is eating. I would say that, is it possible that carbohydrates make you feel less full than when you eat proteins, and that's why the animal decides to eat more carbohydrates than protein. Is that how the animal decides the correct diet?
The mechanism, yes, is a simple answer. The feedbacks coming from protein delay feeding longer than the feedbacks coming from pure carbohydrates. That's absolutely the case. So what you're asking is how these patterns of intake that we see in humans or in other animals over periods of time, how they manifest in the nervous system, in the control systems of the animal. Where are the, using Carlos as parlance, where are the clocks that are recording, the gauges that are recording the status of protein in the body, the status of carbohydrates in the status of fat in the body. And that is one of the really big questions. And prior to this, most of the emphasis has been on calories and how appetite and calories are related to what we're able to say now with some real certainty is that you can't get far by thinking only about calories. You need to consider the source of those calories and their relevant different feedbacks onto behavior, the makeup for protein. We also have separate appetites for sodium, for calcium, but that's another story. You need to add more dimensions to the model to understand that, but that's a simple thing to do.
I would like to know whether you did that study on humans.
Yes.
What were they given to drink with all that buffet? That's one of the questions. If they had alcoholic drinks or soft drinks or just water. And if the smoking or something, other possible habits were controlled.
Absolutely.
That was the first question.
Yeah.
The second one was regarding all those charts you showed on crickets.
Yeah.
Lately on mice and
humans.
What was the trend for, I don't know, I would say a mathematical characterization that you could see across all those graphics.
Mm-hmm.
And what I was asking if you tried to model it mathematically and that you could just say in a biological way Well, it obeys this.
Right. Very good question. Water, they weren't allowed alcohol, they weren't allowed any caffeinated drink either. We had to keep it straightforward into water. Smokers were excluded from the study, as were people with metabolic disease already. And pregnant women were excluded because we know they are peculiar in their dietary habits. So we did control for those things, yes. Mathematically, absolutely, we can represent those, the shapes of those relationships in mathematical form. We do that, we can compare them one to the other to see whether they're statistically different. And we can use them to infer the underlying cost structures and make inferences about how evolution has operated to lead to the development of those mechanisms over evolutionary time. We also use that shape to compare across different types of animals. So I've shown you that omnivores and herbivores, and we're among that group, have a very similar shape. Carnivores don't. So if you look at cats, or you look at mink, or spiders, or predatory beetles, or predatory fish, there's some of the species we've looked at, then they actually don't show that response. They're much more willing to overconsume protein. And that's because they use protein as their principal energy supply, as well as their nitrogen supply, whereas we tend to use protein mainly as our nitrogen supply, and fat and carbohydrate as our energy supply. That one dimension can be split into 20 amino acid dimensions. And that becomes a different level of question. So one way of putting it is, what's the importance of the quality of protein in the diet? In other words, the amount of different amino acid blocks that make up the protein molecules. That's a really important question. Associated with that is which among those amino acids are the key signals that drive protein appetite. That's another set of questions that we're currently, and others are currently exploring. So yes, I've shown you one dimension for protein. The assumption is that the amino acids are pretty close to being in balanced proportions for it to work. If there's one missing or they're in grossly imbalanced proportions, then that axis is treated quite differently.
The other question I would like to put is, in that shape that you show for the diets, in the lower end, there seems to be retreat of the curvature.
The king's apples, yes, exactly. Yeah.
What does it mean?
What that means is that the costs of eating too much protein are slightly less than the costs of eating too little. So if you're lower than the target proportion of protein, you'll keep eating until you line up vertically pretty close. Whereas if you're an excessive protein target, you'll overshoot to a greater degree. So that indicates that there's an asymmetry in the underlying cost structure. It's not quite so bad to overconsume protein as it is to underconsume protein. So there's a break point at the target where it sort of bows out into the
Oh.